Hey guys, Jeremy here with Simple Little Life. I got another knife build video for you today. I'm calling this one the Persian Fighter. Now, I've never made a recurve blade before, and I wanted to give it a try, so let's get right into it. So this was a design that I had just drawn out on paper. I'll cut out that little template that I drew, that little drawing I did, and then I'll use some Super 77 adhesive, and I'll glue that onto a piece of 01 tool steel. Now, this steel is 1/4 inch thick, so it's going to be quite a formidable blade when it's all said and done. We'll just kind of glue it on there, line it up, and then we'll cut it all out with a portable bandsaw. Once we start cutting here, you can kind of get an idea of how thick that material is. That's awful thick to make a knife with. I'm glad I don't do it this thick all the time. It's a lot of extra work. Kind of rough out the general profile, and then we'll jump on the belt grinder. Using the 36 grit ceramic belt here, those things hog off material just like a champ. And then you'll notice for the recurve portion of the blade, I'm actually just getting the exact arch radius that's on my 10-inch contact wheel. So it makes for really, really quick profiling when you can match the profile of certain parts of your knife to the contact wheels that you have. And then we'll do all the detailed cleanup work on the horizontal belt grinder. Get in some of those little nooks and crannies into that finger choil and smooth out the handle a little bit. Get it looking really nice. So once we've got all that done, then we'll take some Sharpie, and I'll mark out some marker on the blade, and then take a drill bit the same diameter as the material thickness you're using and scratch some lines on there, and those will be the lines that we grind to. Also, we're putting a swage on this blade, so I did some on the top there where the swage will go. And ideally, you want those lines to be about 20 thousandths of an inch apart. When I start grinding on my bigger blades, thicker blades, what I'll usually do is I'll start grinding a 45 degree angle, and I'll bring that to that line that we had scribed. So really, I'm not working on the bevel at all here. I'm just trying to get the edge thickness exactly where I want. And it kind of makes it, it's almost like there's more forgiveness in the latter portions of the stages, because you don't have to worry about getting too thin as long as you don't go past where you've already ground to. I really like the challenge that came with this grind. It's a freehand recurve grind, hollow grind, and I'd never done one of those before. And it really is quite interesting the way it makes you think about making your knives. Now, I'll start kind of coming in there and just slowly working. One thing when you're grinding radiuses freehand and hollow grinds is you want to always follow that contour, and you'll notice how I sweep the blade. I don't ever keep the blade flat. You need to be able to move it and manipulate it to kind of follow the curvature of the belly of the knife and that recurve as well. Another important tip is if you notice the belt isn't centered on the wheel, what I'll do is I'll intentionally let it overhang about 3/8 of an inch. And that gives you a little bit of forgiveness, because the plunge line on this knife, I didn't want to be straight. I wanted it to be a sweeping plunge line. And with that belt hanging over, it kind of just, it kind of softens it up, and it lets you get those easy transitions in there. And then here we're grinding the swage on there, again using the 10-inch contact wheel. And that's pretty close for a rough grind. Then we'll finish everything up with a surface conditioning belt. You can think of this as a Scotch-Brite belt. These things work really well, put a really nice finish. If you're not hand finishing your bevels, like satin finishing by hand, these are excellent because they leave a really nice, smooth, uniform finish, and they put a really great grain into the metal. I really, really like these belts. Again, you see that sweeping motion of the blade, constantly moving it to follow the contours of the belly, of the shape of the knife that we've given. Clean up that swage. One tip I would have to say is when you're grinding a knife, just the biggest thing that's helped me is how I approach the grinder. When I come to the grinder and kind of grind like I mean it, with confidence, like I know what I'm doing, it's amazing how it seems that I actually do know what I'm doing. So I used to be timid when I approached the grinder, and I find that it really, really helps to have a little bit of confidence when you're coming up to it. So just keep that in mind. Oh, it looks like a good weapon. Now I'm taking this material. This is a synthetic wood material. It's called, well, they refer to it as WIAC, wood in a can. This is supposed to resemble rosewood, I guess, and it is really, really nasty stuff. I'm doing a two-part scale here, and the other part is going to be a black micarta, canvas micarta. So I'm just going to mark that out and cut that up. And eventually what we're going to do is we're going to glue these two pieces together to create one side of our scale. So a little bit tricky to get everything lined up, but we'll kind of go through that as we come to it. So now that I've cut that out, I'm going to be gluing both of these pieces together on a really thin piece of G10. I'm just using black G10 here, and it's going to kind of act like the base that everything will get glued to and kind of give it a, you know, at least there's one solid piece of material joining these two together when we go to put it onto the knife. And I'm just taking a 1-2-3 block here, squaring it up to the platen. I've got my work rest squared up very accurately. And that way I can grind these blocks that I'm going to be gluing together and get them very precise and flat and 90 degrees so that we have really nice joints. That way they'll butt up really nice and tight. And then this wooden can wasn't entirely flat when I got it, so I'm just kind of flattening it out, checking it on the granite surface plate. Just make sure I've got a really nice flat surface so I'm not stressing it at all when I go to clamp it down. I'm using a figure eight pattern here while I'm sanding. I'm sure it really doesn't matter that much in this application, but if you were, say, doing a really precise surface finish on a piece of metal, say you're lapping the steel, you'll use a figure eight pattern when you're sanding. Apparently it's supposed to make it really nice and true and flat. Again, for this, probably doesn't matter. And then just kind of lining all those pieces up, making sure that it's going to fit. I had to cut that piece of red wood, the synthetic wood, at an angle. Just because of the curve I had in the handle, it wouldn't fit onto the material that I had. So that's why we kind of ground that at an angle there. And then kind of laid out where I want the joint to be and where I want the end of the scales to come. And then we'll lay out where we want our pinholes. We'll center punch those with a little automatic center punch and then crank them in there with a regular punch. And then we'll jump on the drill press. The first three holes I drill are the three holes for the pins. And then after that, we're just doing a whole bunch of random holes for weight reduction. Now, I didn't want to lighten up the handle of this too much because that is a heavy blade hanging off the end of this knife. So, you know, these holes in there, it's also good because epoxy can flow through and kind of bind the two scales together. But really, we didn't get too carried away with weight reduction. And kind of glad after it's all said and done because, like I said, that's a big girthy blade on the end of this thing. And then we're just cleaning everything up, making sure there's no loose fuzzies or anything on the micarta, wiping it all down with lacquer thinner so that the epoxy will bond very well. And I'm using a West Systems two-part epoxy. This stuff is a very slow cure, and this is the first time I'd used it, and I'm really quite happy with it. The nice thing is you have so much working time. I don't think this stuff starts to stiffen up for several hours, and you know, I wouldn't even work at like less than 24 hours into its cure time, but it's really nice when you're doing a setup like this because there's a lot of forgiveness, there's a lot of time. It gives you time to clamp everything properly, and I'm using parchment paper there on my clamps so that it doesn't stick, and I'm clamping that. You can't see it, but there's a big piece of half-inch plate underneath there that I'm clamping everything to just so it's all nice and true and flat. And then I'll use some clamps on the outside to kind of bind those pieces together. Oh, that's a close call. Now we're just going to clean up the edges of this and kind of bring everything back down to its shape, get rid of all the excess G10 that we had. And then also that synthetic wood, I needed to bring that down to the same thickness as the micarta. It's about an eighth of an inch thicker. And then what I'm doing is I'm taking the side that is the G10 side and I'm just sanding it all flat so I can get mostly just for any epoxy that was on the bottom. Now this part is kind of important because that edge that I'm filing right there, that is that represents the joint. If you see that straight line across there, the way that we're going to line these two scale pieces up afterwards is by lining up that bottom edge that we're filing flat. So I want to make sure I get all the epoxy off of that. I don't want to file it down too much, but I just want to make sure it's nice and flat and in line because that is going to be the only way that we can line up these two pieces when we go to drill the holes and get everything bolted together correctly. And now we're going to lay the blade on there and kind of just trace it out. And this is just for future reference so that we can cut out excess material and stuff like that. And kind of mark out where we want the end of the scales to be, what radius we want. Taking extra time here to line up the joint of the two materials so that they line up exactly at that point where the finger choil meets the rest of the handle there, that little point right there. Yeah, I want the material to be exactly in the center of that. Just, I think it would look silly if it was kind of offset one side or the other, so I really, really lined that up very carefully and then clamped it all down. And then I just did a couple spot drills just to mark my holes, and then I came to the drill press and drilled those out. quarter-inch, using quarter-inch pins. I'm using black phenolic pins on this project. I'll cut off the excess. Those were the lines that we'd kind of drawn out previously. Just kind of remove as much of that material as we can, especially that micarta. That stuff does not grind very fast. It is really slow, so as much of it as you can cut off is better than grinding. So now we'll kind of grind it all. You see that little radius that we've drawn on there? That will be the end of the scale, so we'll grind tight to that. Put the knife into these scales here, just so we can kind of get a really close idea. I don't bring it down to the material, but I kind of want to get it close before I glue up. That way I don't have all kinds of extra work after it's all glued together. A lot of dust with this stuff. It was pretty nasty. Now I've got that done. We'll throw the knife in the oven. Did about 15 minutes at 1475, quench it in canola oil, and then we'll temper it. And for the temper, I did two cycles at 40 minutes each at 450 degrees. Also, checking for the temperature, you don't want it to be much cooler than 180 or 200 degrees when you go into your temper. You don't want to let it cool down to room temperature necessarily. Ideally, they say it's best to still have it around 180, 200 degrees and then throw it into your temper. So I was just checking that out. Use the trusty toaster oven. And that's after the second temper cycle. Now I'm just going to clean up the bevels here, do a little hand finishing. The biggest reason is just so that I can remove all that scale that comes off when you're done your heat treat process. I just don't want to clog up all my abrasive belts. I don't know, probably doesn't matter, but it's just a thought. A lot of times you can kind of smooth out little slight imperfections as well when you're hand sanding these bevels. And there's just a little piece of aluminum that I put a radius on, and a piece of leather. So it's a 10-inch radius roughly, and it really helps get that bevel nicely polished up. And then we'll clean up the finish, the flat part of the blade, and where the scales are going to glue on, get that all free and clear of scale. That's weird. And then we went to a Trizact belt to put a really fine finish on. Just kind of clean up the last little details, finish it up really well. And this is always the nerve-wracking part, because you've done so much work to the blade at this point. You know, one wrong move, one little slip, and you can really do a lot of damage to your blade. So that's the part that always makes me uncomfortable. And again, there's that Trizact belt, and we're just cleaning up the inside finger trolls, the handle, just some fine detail work before we glue our scales on. Those Trizact belts are pretty cool. This is the first time I'd ever use them, and they do a fantastic surface finish. I like them a lot better than the Norwax so far. Now we're just going to tape up our bevels so that we don't get any epoxy on them. Protect them. Maybe we don't have to be quite so careful. You know, one little ding against the file or something like that, or the bench vise, and put a scratch in it, that'd be a heartbreak. So I always tape them up. And then I'm just running my Fordham here with a few pieces of sandpaper just to clean out the holes where the pins are going. Mostly so I get really good adhesion with the epoxy, but also just so they don't bind up in there, and so there's a little bit of wiggle room so they'll slide in and out fairly easily. And I'll just sand the holes in the scales as well. And then we're just putting the chamfer on the end of the scales right there. Just because once you glue that on, that is a hard process to do. Now we'll wipe everything down with lacquer thinner and get it all ready for glue up. I gotta switch mats because I got this brand new table mat and I don't want to get epoxy all over it. So yeah, I've got two mats. Lay down some tape that we'll mix the 5-minute epoxy on. This is Devcon 5-minute epoxy. I like this stuff. And gotta work fairly quick because it starts to harden up quite quickly. In 5 minutes, you'll notice it's a lot more difficult to apply, so it's kind of like boom, go time. And put the scales on, slide some pins in, get the other scale on there, and then tap it all together. Then once that's done, we'll put the vise. Slap a couple of vise grips on there to clamp it all in. Again, using parchment paper so our clamps don't stick. And then we'll wipe off all the squeeze out, the little stuff that squishes out. Get that all cleaned up. And that's a rag soaked in lacquer thinner. I really like to take care to get this done very well at this stage, because if you get epoxy hardening on your blade, it's just such a headache to clean up afterwards. So that's a big heavy knife with a big thick handle. We better go slim it down some. It's grinding down to the scales for now, getting the sides flat before we start profiling the handle. doing a, I guess sort of a Coke bottle profile on this one, but first we want to get it all nice and flat and then grind it to the profile of the tang. So we grind all that material down to the steel, get it all to line up nice. For this part of the process, usually I like to use my contact wheel when I can. It's a little smoother and it's just kind of less in the way than a flat platen when you're doing this, especially depending on the shape of the knife and stuff like that, but it works pretty good. And then again, just bringing that scale material so that it matches the tang of the knife. Get it all lined up nicely. I tried my shot back there for dust collection because this stuff is nasty. Also using the Oneida Air Systems Dust Deputy. Gotta put that in there because I love that thing. Now I'm just laying out some lines where I'm going to start my grind, because I'm kind of going to hollow out the sides of the handle here. So I'm just trying to line up a few lines so that I at least have something to work with. I find that once I'm doing this part of the process, it's all kind of by eye anyways. But the idea is if you at least have a couple of guides, you get started, you know, somewhat similar on each side. And then I'm marking a line that I'm going to grind to, just so I don't get the too thin on any part. And there you see, we're just hitting it on the contact wheel, kind of moving material, doing very rough sculpting on here. And the idea behind this is to give it a nice palm swell so that it fits well in the hand. And then also let it flare out as it comes to your pinky there, just so you have a good purchase and it, you know, it gets thicker as it leaves the back of your hand so that as you're swinging it, it's not going to fly out there. This would be a really great place to have this wheel on a horizontal grinder. It would save me from having to kneel down and contort my head at an angle every time I was doing this, but it works. Oh, I'm pretty sure Safety Sally's going to have something to say about this. Something like I'm going to snag my arm off in that belt or something like that. But I'm just using a 1-inch scalped belt here to kind of do some rough profiling. Start smoothing out the handles. I'm not going too crazy in the belt grinder because I'm going to end up finishing this off with a rasp. Now we put in the vise and we've got a rasp here. And I'm just kind of really hogging out the material. If you're unsure, I was a little nervous about this one because I put so much work into this blade and I didn't want to get too crazy on the belt grinder. When you're using sandpaper and rasps and stuff, it's so much more control and it's easier to do a really fine job without wrecking anything, so that's why I opted to do a rasp and hand sanding for most of the finishing on this knife. Now this part was a little tricky because the micarta is so much harder than that synthetic wood, and when I was sanding, you know, I'd be sanding long, and I probably had to sand 3 times longer on the micarta than I did the synthetic wood. So I kind of had to treat it like 2 different areas that I was working on. I couldn't really just sand across the 2 because the synthetic wood would disappear really quickly and the micarta wouldn't, and it was kind of uneven. So it took a little bit more time, and it's kind of a pain in the butt, actually. But in the end, once I kind of learned that, it started to work out. And then we'll give all the steel here a final cleanup, real nice polish, get the grain all back in there by hand. And then just kind of clean up the top of that swage a little bit. And I took all this stuff to 400. Just getting in there one last time. Now, I left the mill scale finish on this blade, and I kind of like the contrast from the nice, shiny, polished-looking bevels and then that mill-scaled flat on the knife. I think that turned out kind of cool. And then I just use AutoSol. This is a metal polish, and I'm just buffing up these scales. This synthetic wood, man, it really buffs up really nice. It looks fantastic. Super smooth, and again, it is kind of difficult to match the micarta to that stuff, but eventually it kind of turned out all right. And here's the finished blade. It's not flawless, it's not perfect, but I'm pretty happy with the way it turned out. Next time, I'm going to be definitely trying a tapered tang, because that is a thick hunk of steel running through there. But as far as my first recurve grind and a hollow grind like that all by hand, I'm really pleased with how it turned out. I'll definitely be doing more of those in the future. Always room for improvement, but for the first one, I'd have to say I'm fairly pleased with how it looks. It's a heavy, heavy, beastly knife. The weight isn't perfect. It's a little bit blade heavy. Having said that, it's probably within about 1 inch of where the index finger would naturally sit, probably within a 0.5 inch. You can see kind of working on the balance there. Almost have your finger in that finger groove and have it perfectly balanced, but not quite. Now, I haven't put the final edge on this knife yet, and the reason for that is that sharpening recurves can be quite problematic to get a really good consistent edge. I've got an idea of a little jig that I'm going to build for my horizontal belt grinder that should make it a much smoother, easier process to do. Once I get that done, I'll probably feature it on my knife maker's vlog. If you haven't checked those out, I encourage you to do so. And that's all for this video, guys. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please consider giving a thumbs up. And if you haven't done so already, please consider subscribing to the channel. Thanks for watching, guys. Cheers.